Our senior pastor, Scott Mays, will be teaching a class on John 1 at this campus each Wednesday night for 12 weeks. Class is open to anyone and everyone. First place for health will start on Wednesday, September the 7th. This class on overall wellness, both physical and spiritual, is open to men and women. Reengage has room for 6 more couples this semester. The Phillips and the Pendles will be leading, and you have to register online to claim your spot. Grab a friend from the neighborhood and make this part of your school routine. Fall into Flowers will be Thursday, September the 8th from 7 to 8:30 at our North Fort Worth campus. You will enjoy a night full of fellowship, delicious desserts, and refreshments while being taught how to make beautiful flower arrangements. I'm in on that. We ask that everyone bring their own quart-sized mason jar for this event. Cost is $15, and you can sign up in the ministry gallery or on rail. Tailgate Sunday will be September the 18th, and former cowboy Kenyon Coleman will be here to share his testimony that morning. Even at the height of his football career, playing in college and being drafted, it was his walk with the Lord that really mattered. After worship, we will have food, games out on the lawn. Invite your friends. And then Mom to Mom will start on Monday, September the 19th at 9:30. And you can sign up on Realm or by the QR code in the ministry gallery. So that is all of the announcements. Okay.
I talked to Kelly this morning about our school snack packs that we're
going to do. Oh, yeah.
And she's going to try to send something out for us to get together on September the 2nd. I think that's on Thursday.
To put snack packs together for Berkshire kiddos. Goodies.
That's goodies for the thing. And we don't have a whole lot of time to work on it, but
what kind of goodies do we want?
Snacks of like chips, meals like mac and cheese and little cups. The only thing is the snack bars do not have any peanut butter in them. No nuts, no peanuts,
no nuts.
So how many do we
and
need?
Well, we deliver about 50 to the school each week.
So it goes pretty quickly.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Those little things, like some, we don't want to give them all something like a candy. Granola bar is not gonna, you know, that mac and cheese is good. Something like that would be, I can't remember what else we had in this snack pack, but they're like three something in the tray, and they need to have like some kind of a protein type thing like that, and then something that would be like a snack. So it could be little gummy things that they have, or it could be applesauce
things, or right.
What you think kids, not what adults like, but what kids like.
Yeah. The fruit roll-up.
Oh, yeah, the fruit roll-ups, that's another good.
So the September 2nd is a Friday.
You know what? I think, yeah, I just looked at that. I think I'll have two September 1st.
And when, and we come here to do it?
Yes.
What time?
It's normally, it's what, 10 o'clock?
Usually about 10, yeah.
And then we just put them together, put them in bags, and just drop them in, so they deliver 50 bags that are sold with them.
You might, you have a tip on that morning, it's gonna be enough to supply for like a month. So even though, am I right?
Right.
Someone's gonna go out and buy more stuff.
Right.
Now, so we haven't got our stuff yet, so we know that, now we're better, understand better what to kind of do.
So like, we need 200 of each thing, because of the bag.
Of course, everybody's pitching.
Yeah.
The whole church is probably.
Oh, we're, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So if we can, bring things like, next Sunday, how many Sundays do we have to work on? One? One? We have one Sunday to work on. So prayer, and then, Kelly will kind of go through to see what's really needed and make a.
List.
Sam's or Costco, and the church will buy things. So, look at that boxes out there, bugs for us to put stuff in.
Yeah, we pretty much at the end of the school year pretty much depleted our whole supply out there.
So we can bring the stuff like next Sunday.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And it'll be in the 8th and here on the coast, right by the where we have to squeeze them. Oh, you did. Okay, what did you bring?
It's roll up gyps now. Something else.
And the last time we got the study, like Costco or something like that, they got nothing in bags.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Okay. I sent these out. So if you got your email, it was a save the date for September the 9th. And David will give us, no. Judy, you let us know.
I've already talked to Judy about this.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. Then I'll shut up. Yep. All right.
Mommy.
Yes, ma'am.
Mommy.
Yes, ma'am. Yep.
I don't know if you can hear me.
Yeah,
I can't hear y'all sometimes, but if you remember my surgery on Tuesday, but last night I had a little episode and ended up had to go to the emergency room, but they checked me all out and they didn't find anything really wrong, but I was standing in the kitchen at the counter and doing some stuff. And then all of a sudden my legs wouldn't work and I kind of had to hold on to the counter until Darlene could get a chair and put under me in. So called the ambulance and let them come get me.
And yeah.
I got to feeling a lot better by the time we made it to the hospital, but they checked everything out and couldn't find anything too wrong. So I came back home. The doctor said he didn't do anything that jeopardized my upcoming surgery. So
Okay.
That's about the size of it.
Well, you are definitely on the prayer list. So.
Does he know the time of the surgery?
Yeah. Donna was asking, do you know the time of your surgery, Will?
Supposed
to be at 7:00 Tuesday morning on the 23rd, and I've been in the hospital, they said probably 4 to 5 days.
Okay. Okay.
So, gonna be over at UT Southwest Hospital in Dallas.
Okay. And Darlene, you will keep us surprised of how Will's doing?
Yeah, I'll keep. Yes.
Okay. All right.
Send you a text.
Okay. Great. Thank you. All right. I have a prayer request that I would like to put on our list. We have some friends, Kim and Scott Hill. Their daughter, Bethany, is not doing well at all. She has leukemia and pretty much sounds like she's in the last stages of leukemia. And so I would like to put Kim and Scott and Bethany on our prayer list.
Probably in her early 30s.
Yeah.
She was the same age as our oldest friend.
Right.
And they were really good friends.
Yeah.
May I give a little update on our granddaughter, Meredith?
Sure.
As you know, she celebrated her 18th birthday on the 13th in drug rehab. And she is still there, which is good. No one can see her except for her parents. Her parents are able to see her, I think, one day a week. But she is getting counseling and she's fighting not only the drug withdrawals, but she's fighting suicidal thoughts and depression. So this young lady needs our prayers to get her through this terrible ordeal. And her parents, her dad, which is my son, is so torn about this that I worry about his health too now, because he's not his body's not strong. He has some disabilities himself, and so it's just a hard thing for them to have to be going through right now. And my son's not getting any help from the ex-wife. She's fighting him all the way. She doesn't want the daughter to be in there. Yeah. And
she's in denial.
She's in total denial. And she's been diagnosed as being addicted to fentanyl.
We did mention to Rob about Celebrate Recovery and you know, that it's for the family too. So
just to piggyback on that, our sober recovery has grown, and growing means that we not only have more people, but we have more challenges. And some are right here in our own church family. And of course, just like Meredith, this kind of situation. And we're talking about, whether you're talking about prison time for people, or drug rehab, or families that are trying to get help but can't get anyone to say yes to help them. It's really a big deal. And we've told you before that, you know, our desire is to start with the youth and children part of this deal next January. That's our prayer and hope. But please pray for all of us who are in CR. We've got two couples right here that we're in it all the time. And we know that they're just some big challenges, but we believe in a big God, and we're praying for miracles. So thanks for the prayer support.
I'll get a report on when to get to the doctor this week. So they do have three doctors lined up. I just pray that William will go through with it now. He's got the doors open if he will just
according to the conference.
See the doctors. And so I appreciate your prayers.
Yeah.
William does have a sweet attitude right now. He's not
right.
But he just, I think with all the baggage of his past and all, he just
It's just hard for him to get past it.
Yeah. We lost them for a while. They weren't up here at all.
Okay.
So they probably don't even know what we're talking about.
Herb, could I ask you to lead us in a word of prayer, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you with grateful hearts for all that you've done for us, and yet with concerned hearts, asking for your healing upon these that have been lifted up to you today. Father, we pray that as you know each need, we just ask for a touch from you in each case, and to the surrounding families as well, and those official people that might be ministering to them. Lord, we ask your blessings upon them. Guide their hands in procedures and their voices, Father, their minds in guidance and counseling. Father, we just ask your blessings upon each of us as we go day to day, trusting you, Father, and help us keep us walking in your footsteps. Help us continue to bring glory and honor to you in all that we do, all that we think, all that we say. And Father, we just pray now for Robert as he leads the class discussion today, teaches the lesson. Bless us, Father, and help us to bless you. These things I ask in your name. Amen.
Thank you. All right.
Well, those of you on Zoom, the message keeps coming on the screen that this connection is unstable. So I feel very unstable myself. So it doesn't encourage me when that message comes on the screen. But
and it's up all the
way. Okay. All right. Good deal. So we have some questions on the board to kind of help kick us off this morning. So if this problem surfaces, your air conditioner breaks in July, who would you call?
Repairman.
Okay, call the repairman. Kelvin?
I think mine did.
Okay. But you got it fixed.
And drift it outside.
All right, call the repairman. All right. And the other one says, a tree falls on your house. Well, who are you going to call on that one?
Maybe Wallace.
Get Wallace over there. Any other tree falls on the house?
Make a tree house.
Make a tree house. Oh boy. And then it says your kitchen faucet erupts like a geyser.
Don't call me.
Do not call Wallace. Who are you gonna call for that one? A plumber. Okay. All right. Okay. I don't even know which plumber to call, but anyway. And
then, cut off the water first.
Yeah, turn the water off. That'd be a good plan to start with. Well, what if your dryer catches fire? Who are you going to call for that? Fire department, yeah. Yeah, maybe to get someone to clean it, and who knows what else we're going to have to deal with. Well, the fact is, what's that? It froze up, okay. Well, sometimes a crisis comes around and we're not exactly sure who to call. We're not sure what to do about this. But it sounds like you guys, this is a legacy group. We've all had some of these experiences. So you know who to call. But I've asked Judy to read from our lesson material, read a few sentences, and then there are a couple of questions that she's going to put out there for us to discuss for just a second. So if you can read the comments here about prayer.
Prayer is an invitation into the throne room of God. This invitation is about having a conversation with the creator of the universe and being ushered into his presence as someone he desires to spend time with. God wants to hear from us and to show us his wisdom and plans. Like any other invitation, we must choose to accept it. Too many times we expect God to act, but do so without approaching him. So the first question is, why might people ignore God even when facing a crisis?
Why might people ignore God even when facing a crisis? What are your thoughts?
They don't know when to begin with.
Okay, kind of like what Pastor Chris was talking about this morning. You know, people have made a choice not to turn to God, not to depend upon him. What else? Why would people not pray?
They don't believe in the power of prayer.
They don't believe in the power of prayer.
They're so discouraged and really down.
Okay.
They give up.
Okay. I've tried everything. Discouraged, giving up.
Hate themselves.
Okay, hate themselves? Okay.
No, darling, they think they can do it all themselves.
They think they can do it all themselves. Okay, that's another issue. I've actually met people that would say they don't know how to pray. They don't know, you know, does it have to be a speech? Does it have to have certain words? You know, there are people that literally don't know how to pray. There's another question on this. What else did it say?
What amazes you most about God's desire to hear our prayers?
What amazes you the most about God's desire to hear your prayers?
That he cares that much about them.
Okay. He cares that much?
And then it doesn't matter that there's 7 billion people in the world. He can hear them all.
Yeah. Even if all 7 billion were praying, God wouldn't miss any of it, would he? Any other thought? What amazes you the most about God hearing our prayers?
No prayer is too small.
No prayer is too small or too big.
And sometimes when we pray and we find out that God has been answering that prayer before you ever voiced it, when we find out how it all rolls out.
Well, there's some wonderful mysteries. And I want to say to you, I don't know how you feel about our study these last 11, 12 weeks that we've been in First and Second Kings. And by the way, David, thank you so much for teaching last week. I got to enjoy your lesson on Monday while I was on the exercise bike. I listened to the lesson. I was able to focus very well. Really appreciate it. But I don't know about what some of you may be thinking over the last number of weeks as we've looked at all these kings and some of their diabolical behavior and so forth. But if you've had a chance to prepare and study the scripture we're looking at for this morning, it's encouraging. Very, very encouraging. Title of our lesson, God Hears. And we're going to look at this man who was a king in the south, in Judah, Hezekiah. And one of the things that we learn about the situation is that there was a conflict between that emerged between Hezekiah, who's the king in Judah, and who else? Who's the other one? Who's the other person that there's a conflict that emerged? Him and another king. You know the king's name? Well, Sennacherib. Okay, Sennacherib, not snack of ribs, but Sennacherib. Okay, and so what exactly was the conflict? Well, he was demanding royalty. He was demanding assets, and Hezekiah is not going to do it. And you know, one of the things that struck me as I was thinking about this particular component was it was in 2013 or 2014, Don and I traveled to Indonesia. And one of the things that was very interesting in that experience, and it was part of our mission work, and we connected with two men who were involved in ministry, and they were like our hosts for the 5 days that we were there. Every place we went, there was somebody that would approach us, the four of us, and it was evident they wanted money. We took a ferry. We bought tickets to get on the ferry. And before we got on the ferry, before we even gave anyone a ticket, money had to be given. And then the ticket was given. We got on the ferry and sat down. Someone else appeared and wanted money. When we got off the ferry, somebody was ready to receive money. It seemed like it never, ever stopped. And one of the things that we learned in that 5 days was you don't argue. You just, these guys said, we'll take care of it. They always gave the money. We didn't give the money. They always gave the money. They knew who to give it to. They knew how much to give them. They knew that what would happen if they didn't do it. And they just took care of it. They were watching over us. They didn't think of it that way, but they were very much protecting us. So this was a very, you know, ratcheted up all kinds of levels. What's going on between Hezekiah and Sennacherib? This king of Assyria, he thinks he is somebody fantastic, and he expects Hezekiah to conform to what he's telling him to do. Now, the other thing to know about Hezekiah is when he came to the place of rule and responsibility, things took a dramatic change. And I want to just pull up a little bit of information. We'll share the screen here if I can get this in place. Bear with me, if you will, please, while I pull this up, this PowerPoint. And getting myself together here. All right, so we're right here, the latter part of the book of 2 Kings, the kingdom of Judah, from Hezekiah onto the captivity. And one of the things you see here is the kings of the divided kingdom on the right. You see Hezekiah and the years that he served and reigned here on the right. And then on the left, the Assyrian rulers, you see Sennacherib. So he's the one in power of Assyria. And get this in your mind. He is advancing his control further and further and further and closer to Judah, the southern kingdom. I mean, it's like dominoes are falling. That's exactly what's taking place. One king after another, one ruler after another is being toppled by this man. And so you see the colored areas here, which are the Assyrian districts that are outlined on this map. And you know, it's like, Hezekiah, you're next. He's gotten all these other people, and now he's coming to Hezekiah. The thing, though, about Hezekiah in Judah, though, was that he was trying to turn the nation and turn the people back to a loyalty to the Lord and to honor him. He was trying to restore the sacrificial system that the people of God had just kind of turned their backs on. And he's trying to restore all that. He had a celebration of the Passover in Jerusalem. They hadn't done that for a long time, but he did that. He was trying to get people to conform to that. But here comes this king of Assyria. And he's trying to disrupt all this. He's trying to interrupt all of this advance spiritually in the nation. And we're going to see, though, in just a minute, the response that Hezekiah has to all this that's taking place. Hezekiah, after this event, this lesson that we're looking at this morning, the scriptures that we're looking at this morning, after this, later he became very ill to the point of death. Isaiah came in, and because of a prayer that he prayed to God, God extended his life 15 years. Unfortunately, in that extension of his life, he got a little bit proud, you know? And there were some visitors that came in from Babylonia, and he went and took them through every part of his assets and let them, let me show you this, let me show you this, let me show you that, let me show you everything. Well, the result of that was not good. And his son succeeded him as king, Manasseh. I don't know if that name rings a bell to you or not, but Manasseh was one nasty, wicked ruler. But if you don't think some people can repent, even this man, with all of his wickedness, Manasseh, the scripture records in the book of Chronicles that he did repent. But that's further on after this lesson. But that just kind of gives you a little bit of the context of what we're dealing with this morning. But if you want to turn your Bible to 2 Kings 19, and we're going to look at verses 10 and following, if you want to get that passage up, and we'll look at that. And I don't recall who has verses 10 through 13. Okay, Wallace has verses 10 and 13. 2 Kings 19, we're going to see here the taunt from this man, Sennacherib.
Thus shall you speak to
Hezekiah.
King of Judah, do not let God trust the seat by promising that Jerusalem will not be given to the hand of Asura. Behold, you have heard what kings of Asura have done to all lands, devoting them to destruction, and shall you be delivered. As the God said, the nations within the bounds, the nations of my fathers destroyed, Hosan, Aram, Rizia, and the people of Israel, and tells them where the king of Shemana, the king of Arpad, the king of the city, the sectors of the king of Hannah, or the king of.
Thank you. So the king of Assyria, Sennacherib, is trying to instill fear into Hezekiah. Look at all that I've done, all these other kings toppling like dominoes. You're next. I'm coming for you. And he just taunts Hezekiah with verse 10 there, you know, do not let your God in whom you trust deceive you by promising that Jerusalem will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. So this statement, Sennacherib sends his messengers down to Hezekiah. This message is written down, but those guys that bring the message, they also stand out publicly, maybe in the public square, and they're declaring, this is what's going to happen. Don't think that your God is going to deliver you in this situation. Don't let him deceive you. And the bottom line is that the king, Hezekiah, his honor is at stake. But who else's honor is at stake? God himself. His honor is at stake. And so we don't know why the messengers that are sent down from Sennacherib, that come down from Assyria, we don't know why they would think themselves, because they don't know God, why they think that he's promising to deliver. Maybe they got it secondhand, a secondhand message. We don't know for sure how they got that. Maybe it was just an educated guess on their part. We know these people who claim to worship the God of heaven. This is what they're thinking. And so in verse 11, notice what it says. in this message that is being given, that word that you see every once in a while, behold. Think of it this way. That word behold is like, listen up, guys. Pay attention. In other words, this is just a very clear, adamant statement. Listen here. You're not going to get away from this. You're next. Hezekiah is not going to escape downfall. And then in verse 12, it says, have the gods of the nations delivered them, the nations that my fathers destroyed? This rhetorical question, you know, there's no way you're getting around this. You're next. So what would be the word, a five-letter word, to describe this king, Sennacherib, sending these messengers down here to Hezekiah? What would be the five-letter word we would use to describe the attitude that's in Sennacherib's mind and heart? Five-letter word. Donnie, you do Wordle all the time. It's a five-letter word. Should be able to come up. Pride! Think about Proverbs 16, verse 18. What comes before a fall? Pride. And so here's this guy who is proud. Yes, Assyria up to now has taken over everybody they wanted to take over. But this person is prideful. And, you know, you could say from a worldly standpoint, he's been successful, this king. From a worldly standpoint, he's done what he went to do. He's been successful. But pride comes before a fall. And it can happen even to people who are wanting to live for the Lord. We can sometimes get prideful. We can sometimes think too highly of ourselves. But you all know this verse, book of Zechariah, chapter 4, verse 6. This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. You know this passage, 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 7. What do you have that you did not receive? If you then received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? I think most of us in this room that we want to stand on, there must be accountability that we have before the Lord. Well, let's look now. The heart of this passage is in verses 14. It's a rocky morning. It's like a rodeo Zoom session. We're going to look at verses 14 through 19, and I believe Tommy has these verses, and if you'll follow along in your copy.
Hezekiah received a letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed before the Lord and said, O Lord, the God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim, you are the God. You alone of all the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth. Incline your ear, O Lord. Hear, open your eyes, O Lord, and see, and hear the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to mock the living God. Truly, O Lord, the kings of Assyria had laid waste to the nations and their lands and cast their gods into the fire, for they were not gods, but the work of hands, the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore, they were destroyed. So now, O Lord, our God, save us, please, from his hand, and all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you, O Lord, are God alone.
Remarkable prayer. I went back and just circled each time he addresses, O God, and he says, you and your, just time and time and time in this passage, he is speaking out directly to the Lord. And you know, the letter that he got received the ultimatum from Sennacherib. He knew what was being declared. He knew the demands that were being placed upon him. But what is Hezekiah's response in that situation? Does he call in a committee? Does he call in a council of leaders and so forth? What does he do?
Pray.
He prays. Somebody said, prayer must be our first choice, not our last chance. It must be our first choice. And that's exactly what he did. You know, his response here is echoing what one of the earlier kings, Solomon, did. In 1 Kings chapter 8, it references something that Solomon did when he talked to the Lord. He said, when your people Israel are defeated before the enemy because they have sinned against you, and if they turn again to you and acknowledge your name and pray and plead with you in this house, then here in heaven, forgive the sin of your people Israel and bring them again to the hand, to the land that you gave to their fathers. So I want to ask you, as you read this passage that Tommy just read here, these verses, why do you think Hezekiah took this letter from the king of Assyria? Why would he take this letter and spread it out in front of him before the Lord and then pray? Why would he do that? Why that particular action to open this letter and spread it out before him? Any thoughts?
I think you see this traditionally, that they do things like that, but they bring things before God, that it's like a sacrifice, but it's like presenting it, here it is, and here I am. And I know even in Chinese, one of the words they use is that I've placed this before your feet. It's very much like a concept that they have. I'm bringing this to you. This is the literally what it is. I'm
coming
before you.
Okay. Laying your sins out there. So he's laying this out there for everyone, not only so that they all understood what it was, that was the issue.
Okay. And, you know, it's a physical gesture of what the prayer was about. This is something beyond me, God. This is something I can't resolve. This is an issue greater than any other nation has been able to deal with. I don't know how to deal with it. I'm going to deal with it by bringing it to you. I'm placing this before you. I'm putting this in your hands. I need your wisdom. And notice the statements that he identifies here in this prayer. The Lord, our Lord, as Hezekiah is praying to him, the Lord is unique over all lands in this entire universe. There is no one like God. There are people that say they have gods. There are people that say they worship this and they worship that, but there is none like Almighty God. He is unique. And he goes on to talk about that he is above all the universe. Talks here really is referencing like the Ark of the Covenant and the cherubim that were on top of that. And just, you know, God, you're greater than all this. You're above all. You are unique of all the kingdoms on this earth. You are unique. Your kingdom is unique. Yeah, the Assyrians, they have their god, Asherah. They have their God. The other nations have their gods. You know, a polytheistic view. You know, you need this God, you need this God, you need that God. You know, one of the things that we don't grasp as quickly, I think, here in the United States so much, that you find so typical in animistic environments around the world, is the many gods that are worshipped. I give you two in Taiwan. One is Matsu. Well, what in the world is that? It's the name of a female goddess over the sea. Sailors, people traveling in the waters, in the ocean, they will appeal to Matzo for safety as they journey. What about Todegong? That's the earth god in Taiwan. If you are in agriculture, you're a farmer, you will worship the earth god because you want good crops. You want your land to be prosperous. And there's a host of other gods that are worshiped. Go to one other country, go another country, another place, you'll find more and more and more. But God is the maker of heaven and earth. He created it all. What does Colossians chapter 1 say about him? He is before all things, and in him all things, what? Hold together. He is the creator. So in verse 16 to 19 in this passage here in Hezekiah's prayer, he's appealing to God, in, if you will, in front of all these that would think about other gods and other things to worship. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes and see. It's an urgent prayer that he is praying to God in this particular moment. And he talks about to him about the words of Sennacherib, which were an attempt to mock the living God. You know, kind of like, you know, you think about David and Goliath. What did Goliath do before David used the slingshot to kill him? Goliath was out there day after day after day after day mocking these soldiers.
He taunted.
Yeah, he taunted them. And that's what Sennacherib is doing. And so Hezekiah in this prayer is acknowledging there is only one God. There are not many. There's one. He's the only one worthy to be called God. Why? There's a passage in Psalm 115. And I'm sure you've read this passage when it talks about the idols that the human beings have created. The idols are silver and gold, the work of human hands. They have mouths, but they don't speak. They have eyes, but they don't see. They have ears, they don't hear. Noses, but they do not smell. Hands, but they do not feel. Feet, but do not walk. They do not make a sound in their throat. Those who make them become like them. So do all who trust in them. I think I probably told you all the story about the time we were flying on a flight from Kaohsiung, Taiwan, over to Thailand. And there were a group of worshipers that had taken the god out of their temple. And guess how that god got on the plane with us to go to Thailand? And this guy walks in with the god in his arms. I thought, okay, this is interesting. And on the best seats in the coach section, the front row, where there are no seats in front, you know, the TV screens up here, they put that god in a seat, and he put a seat belt around the god to keep him in his seat. And then when the snacks and beverages were served, here comes that guy from the back of the plane back up to the idol and gives a snack of whatever it was and lays it right there by the idol. I mean, that's why this passage in Psalm 115 says all it is. Look at these idols. This idol, he couldn't feed himself. He couldn't put on his own seatbelt. He couldn't walk on the plane. He can't do any of that because he's not God. And so, yeah, Assyria had done a lot of things, but Hezekiah is appealing to the creator, the maker of heaven and earth. Now, O Lord, our God, save us, please, from his hand. And what's his hope? What's his desire? That they will know that God is almighty. What do you take away from this prayer of Hezekiah? What lesson or lessons do you take away from his prayer in this passage?
One that he absolutely knew that there was no way that this was going to be resolved. God didn't do it. This was like beyond any human ability. And he went to God in faith, believing that this is my only chance to be gone.
Okay. What was his heart? What was his attitude in coming before God? Certainly not pride, but humility. Very definitely. Hezekiah asked the Lord to intervene, and his desire was ultimately that God's name be glorified. You know that passage in Isaiah chapter 55 when God says, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither your ways my ways," declares the Lord. "For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." You know the passage in Ephesians 3 and verse 20, which says, "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us." We Sunday by Sunday and day by day, we all have and are facing some significant challenges in our lives. And we've heard some of those again this morning as we come to the Lord in prayer. And it's simply a reminder to us again that we pray, God, that you show your greatness in this situation, in this critical situation that we're dealing with at this particular moment. Let's look further at verses 32 through 34, and God answers his prayer. Okay, Kelvin is going to read, if you'll follow along, verses 32 through verse 34.
"Therefore, God spake to all concerning the kingdom Ashdod, he should not come into the city or shoot there, or come forward with a shield or cast up a sheep mound against him. By the way that he came, by the same he shall return, he shall not come into the city there to the Lord. For I will defend the city, save it for my own sake, and for the sake of my servant David."
God knew everything about Sennacherib. He knew about all of his plans, all of his attention, and he said, "It is not going to happen. It's not going to happen." And he's very specific, as in this answer, he points to specific acts of warfare that Sennacherib would probably want to use, or that was typical to be used. Can you see what they were? What were the specific things that God states here? "He's not going to do this. He's not going to do this. He's not going to do that." What were they? Okay. So when they would fight, okay, one of the things that they would do would be to shoot arrows. Attacking armies might just send over scads of arrows flying through the air to keep the citizens pinned down and stop them from advancing. He's not going to do that. He's not going to be allowed to do that. What else?
Or shields,
okay? Then soldiers would carry the shields for their own protection. They're not going to be able to do that. What else? And what? Okay, they're not going to be able to put a ramp up there to go over the wall around the city. They're not going to be able to do that. Anything else? Okay, so and God says specifically in verse 33 and 34, "I will defend the city to save it." Okay, he's going to intervene and work in this situation. And I know that these verses were not in our lesson, but we can't leave this story hanging without reading the verses. So if you look at verse 35 through verse 37, I want us to just look at what happens here, how God does what he says he's going to do. Look at it. Verse 35. "And that night, the angel of the Lord went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. And when people arose early in the morning, behold, these were all dead bodies. Then Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed, went home, lived at Nineveh. And as he was worshiping in the house of Nishrak, his god, Adrammelech, and Sharezer, his sons, struck him down with the sword and escaped into the land of Ararat. And Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his place. God heard the prayer of Hezekiah, and he answered it so amazingly and so dramatically. My question to you as we kind of tie up the ends of our lesson this morning is this: how does God defend his name today in 2022? How does he defend his name today in our world?
He uses us.
Okay, he uses us as we live, as we pray, okay?
Sometimes he goes beyond us in ways that we can't explain.
Okay.
I think I told the story of the guys that were Muslims who were getting baptized. They had become Christians. And a whole truck of guys came up, pulled up to slaughter them. And Jesus appeared, and no one could explain that. And those people in the truck, all but one, believed in Jesus. That's not something that we can explain without our own people. God can do whatever he wants to.
I think that people have said the same thing before, that there are times when they just didn't understand why something didn't happen that they were just sure that it was going to happen. He didn't make a big production out of it. It just occurred.
Yeah. Let me just share these particular phrases with you about prayer as we think about what is the purpose of prayer. Praying allows us to communicate with God. Prayer allows us to hear his instructions. And if we are patient and wait, he will guide us as to what we need to do next. In prayer, we draw near to him. Prayer helps us to realize he is God, we're not. And prayer acknowledges that God made us and he knows what to do next. In chapter 19 and verse 19, I think this is a verse that we might want to carry with us away from this lesson. If you look at it in verse 19 of chapter 19, "So now, O Lord, our God, save us, please, from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you, O Lord, are God alone." I don't know about you, but I think sometimes, if I'm not careful, my praying will begin to revolve around me and not around his name being honored and his name being lifted high. And certainly that is a key component that we carry with us as we pray and as we speak with him. I'm gonna ask us to have a time of prayer in just a second by using a song and letting the song and the message of the song kind of be an aid as we pray. But any other thoughts or any other comments that you wish to share from this prayer of Hezekiah? Any other thoughts?
I think that prayer is definitely one for this time.
Absolutely. Yeah. We just lay it all out there before him. We can't fix it. Can't fix it. We don't have the power. I'm gonna ask us to just have a time of prayer, a time of worship. I'm gonna play a song that is not as contemporary as a lot of our contemporary songs, but still one of the contemporary songs that was popular, particularly a number of years ago. And I'm gonna just let this be kind of a background as we pray and as we speak with the Lord at this time.
It's all about you, Jesus, and all this is for you, for your glory and your fame. It's not about me, as if you should do things my way.
Father, we thank you for your word and how your word underscores to us the value, the importance, and the place of seeking you and coming to you and laying every burden of our lives, every thanksgiving from our hearts, Lord, before you. And we pray that you will guide our steps each and every day. Lord, help us to focus on you, to take the trials of this world and this life, the concerns and things that are capturing our minds and our energy, Lord, to lay them before you, to put our absolute trust in you. Thank you for this time of worship, fellowship, study. May your name be honored. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Thank you, guys. And Will, Darlene, will be especially continuing to pray for you guys this week. And thanks for keeping us updated. Joyce and TD, good to see you all.
Thank you.
Sorry for the staggering internet, but y'all are very patient.
I don't think that's in your control totally.